Thank you. Apologize for the delay, but I think we're now ready to proceed for the last case on our docket this morning, which is the case of Michael Rattagan versus Uber Technologies. So if counsel are ready to begin, you may proceed. Please state your appearance.
Andrew August Steyer Lowenthal, appearing on behalf of the appellant, Michael Rattagan.
You may proceed.
Oh, thank you, Your Honor. I would like to reserve 5 minutes of rebuttal time. I want to make sure I have the court's clock in my view. I do. Okay. So, good afternoon, Your Honors, from finally a wet, rainy Sonoma County, California. I'm privileged to appear before you on this important matter. My office took this case to right or wrong. If Mr. Rattagan's story was true, we thought, Uber's conduct was cold, calculating, and reprehensible. Granted, we inherited an admittedly poorly investigated case with pleading problems. My colleague, Alan Steyer, and I traveled to Buenos Aires to meet with Mr. Rattagan, other witnesses, and to review a treasure trove of documents. Essentially, we concluded that Uber hung Mr. Rattagan out to dry, and in the process of doing so, misrepresented to the trial court, the district court, the very attorney-client relationship that is at the core of this case. It drove us, all those documents and the witness interviews drove us to draft a very, very detailed Third Amendment complaint. That's the complaint before this court. However, because of prior counsel's missteps, and perhaps understandably, by the time we got to the Third Amendment complaint, Judge Chen was predisposed to a skeptical view of the allegations. This case comes to you, however, on review of a judgment following grant of the 12B6 motion as to the Third Amendment complaint. It's not an Iqbal Twombly analysis the court's being asked to consider. Rather, there are pure questions of law here, three in particular that I would like to try and address this morning. One is the application of the threshold of the economic loss rule. The second one would be the independent duty exception to that rule. And the third would be the special relationship exception. Two of those issues highlight conflicts among the district courts in California on issues that have not yet been directly addressed by the California Supreme Court, namely the whether or not fraudulent concealment is within or without the economic loss rule, and the applicability of the special relationship exception when the parties are actually in privity of contract. The ruling in the court below and Uber's positions here, if affirmed, create very serious social policy concern for civil litigants. We will have a policy that distinguishes between species of intentional fraud. If there's fraudulent inducement, there's no question, that's outside the rule. If we have affirmative fraudulent statements, that too is outside the rule. But if we have intentional fraudulent omissions and concealment in the course of the party's transactions post-contract formation, that's within the rule. There is no justification for distinguishing between species of fraud, intentional fraud.
So Mr. August, I guess let me just ask you some basic questions here. So I guess we have to determine, or do you agree we have to determine whether your client's claims arise out of a contractual relationship or if they arise out of an independent court duty?
Well, that is clearly one of the crucial crux issues in this case. And if you look at the pleading as a whole, forget about just identifying or focusing on the third, I believe it was the third cause of action, the title of the third cause of action. The independent duty here is the duty of disclosure. Now, how we get there is part of my presentation this morning, but that's the duty of Uber as a client to disclose material facts to its lawyer.
What is your bet? Your time's going to go very quickly here. What is your best argument for why the law imposes a duty on a client to disclose information to his attorney?
There are three bases. Well, you're talking about from a policy perspective. Well, there's three bases for the duty. One is the confidential relationship between attorney and client, which is different, as we argued in our brief, different than the fiduciary duty. The principal agency relationship between attorney and client, and the duty of the principal to deal fairly with the agent. And most importantly, in this case, social policy. Social policy should advance full and complete disclosure of all material facts between and among the lawyer and the client. That will minimize disputes between the lawyer and the client. California has a legitimate, compelling interest in preventing intentionally fraudulent behavior. And you'll hear me emphasize the word intentional here, because that's what this case is about, concealment. That's intent. Fraud actions advance the social interest in punishing intentional actions. We know that. It deters future actions. And to quote one court, it says, because of the extra measure of blameworthiness inherent in fraud, and because in fraud cases, we are not concerned about the need for predictability about the cost of contractual relationships, fraud plaintiffs may recover out-of-pocket damages in addition to the benefit of the bargain. So, and ultimately, Your Honor, here, Mr. Rattagan suffered no contract damages, none. He was paid for his services. So I'm not sure that that fully addressed your question, but the independent basis is really what is that this court really needs to focus on in our estimation. Do clients get a free pass, a blanket immunity from misrepresenting or not misrepresenting, because we cannot allege affirmative misrepresentations at the threshold of the relationship?
I'm just not sure I've seen any examples of those principles being applied to an attorney-client relationship in our case law, I guess. And we're really having to focus on California law here, I think, in the Robinson decision by the California Supreme Court. And I guess, what is your best argument for why we should go beyond the California Supreme Court's narrow decision in Robinson and should basically conclude that fraudulent concealment is also exempted from the economic loss rule?
Your Honor, I think that the district courts below that have said Robinson was a narrow decision, you just use the word narrow. I think those district courts were, they misread the decision. There's a sentence that I, again, want to quote here. This is verbatim from the Robinson decision. Because Dana's affirmative intentional misrepresentations of fact, i.e. the issuance of false certifications of conformance, are dispositive fraudulent conduct related to the performance of the contract, we need not address the issue of whether Dana's intentional concealment constitutes an independent tort. The California Supreme Court specifically declined to address that issue. To say that it addressed that issue sub silentio, I think this court is well aware that.
Right, but counsel, forgive me for interrupting, but that is Judge Murguia's question. They didn't reach it, and her question was, why should we go beyond Robinson?
Because the policies governing fraud as fraud, whether it be in the form of fraud in the inducement, whether it be fraud in the form of an affirmative misrepresentation, whether it be fraud in concealment or omission, they're all fraud. They are subsections of fraud, and there's no policy justification ever articulated that I have seen by any court for drawing a distinction between those species of intentional fraud.
But I guess California specifically decided not to address whether the exception extends to fraudulent concealment.
So that is correct.
Is this appropriate for certification? Is that something that we should be considering here?
Well, I believe in either our opening or our reply brief, we did embrace that idea, because the California Supreme Court has not addressed that. There is a split amongst the districts in this circuit. There's a split amongst the state court decisions. And I think that, frankly, is something that this court should consider.
Well, we have a different relationship with the California Supreme Court than we do with other Supreme Courts in the states. I was involved with the working through the direction of our chief judge, was trying to get all the states to come into this so that we could use it when it was firstly opened. And California made it clear that, A, they aren't going to accept anything from trial courts, and that's California is the only one that'll do that. No questions from trial courts. And that they will make their own judgments on questions that come from the Court of Appeals. So we don't have a free rein to go over and check out with the California Supreme Court. And clearly, the district courts are not unanimous on their approach to this issue. Now, I'm a little bit bothered by the Supreme Court saying earlier, we don't want to get into this. But I suggest that some consideration you should give to certifying it again under new ground rules, what's going on now in our district courts, because it's not to the benefit of California law generally to have our district courts on issues as important as these going in different ways. So I'm with that background. Would you support a certification approach, even though we may not win? Is it worth the time to give it a try?
I think because of the importance of this issue, Your Honor, I think if this court declines to predict what the California Supreme Court would do if it was presented with this case, because that is the other option. This court can predict what the California Supreme Court would do. That is what Judge Corley did with respect to the special relationship exception to the rule in her decision in the E-Trade case. So the court has, I think, two avenues. This court has two avenues to pursue.
Have there been any California intermediate appeal cases on this issue? If the Supreme Court hasn't made the determination, has there been any cases at all from the intermediate California courts of appeal on this issue?
I have not seen any, Your Honor. We spent a fair amount of time yesterday updating our research. I have not seen them. What I will refer the court to, though, is the Southern California, I think it's the Southern California gas cases that we cited, which was a Supreme Court decision, California Supreme Court decision, where you can see how the court has balanced the policy considerations with both for and against the application of the economic loss rule. And that case, which was relied on by a few of the district court judges that have handled this, that case, I believe, counsels that fraud is fraud. And one of the issues we haven't addressed here, but fraud is fraud. And both other judges had asked, you know, are we dealing with an issue here where what's the independent duty? Well, the independent duty, again, derives from this policy, this public policy issue. And we do not have a contract here like there are in virtually every single other case where you have a very detailed contract, whether it be, I mean, and the cases are legion with the Lemon Law cases. The court may be familiar with those. So that's probably 70% of the case law in the district courts involving this issue. But I think that, again, go back to the courts, Judge Wallace, your point. Do I think it's worth it? I do think it's worth it because this is such a critical issue.
Going away either.
Yeah, either way.
No, it's not going away. It's going to be staying.
Oh, that too. It's not going to go away.
You have 50 seconds left. I know you wanted to reserve more, but
unless any of the judges have any questions, I'm done.
All right.
Thank you for your efforts here this morning.
Mr. Davidson, would you like to state your appearance, please?
Yes, Jeffrey Davidson, Covington and Berlin, on behalf of Uber Technologies. I'd like to frame this case a little bit and then get to the court's questions about certification, because this would be a very poor case indeed to try a certification. The economic loss rule generally prohibits parties from asserting tort claims when there's a contractual relationship between them. And there's a powerful idea behind it, which is that when the parties have organized themselves and decided their obligations to each other through private contracting, the court should respect that rather than expanding those duties through tort law. Now, in this case, Mr. Rattagan alleged in his complaint that there was an implied in fact attorney-client contract between him and Uber. And in paragraph 94 of his complaint, he alleged that the parties, quote, were in express and or implied contractual relationships arising from Uber Technologies and Rattagan's direct attorney-client relationship. And then in paragraph 95 of his complaint, he alleged that an element of this alleged contract was that Uber Technologies was required to inform Rattagan of his business plans. And then he went on to allege an explicit breach of contract claim based on that contract. That's count three of his third amended complaint. But he missed the statute of limitations for that contract claim. And to get around that problem, what he did was to recast his contract claim as tort. He took exactly the same facts from his contract claim and turned them into tort claims. And so paragraphs 83 and 84 of his complaint addressing fraud identify the same duty and the same source. And that's right at the dead center of what's forbidden by the economic loss rule, taking contract claims and repackaging them as torts. And that's why the district court here got it exactly right. Now on appeal, Rattagan has a number of arguments. Most of them were waived and not presented to the district court. And I ought to address waiver for a second because it's a threshold issue before you get into any of the complexities of the economic loss rule. Rattagan acknowledged in his briefing that he didn't raise his argument that the economic loss rule doesn't apply to fraudulent omissions or that he qualifies for the professional services exception. So the argument that was identified in Mr. August's turn for certification was never raised in the district court. So in terms of certifying an issue to the California Supreme Court, presenting them with arguments that were raised in the, that were waived in the district court is very unlikely to
be
successful.
This isn't something that you waive. It's something that we do if we want to do. But I think we would be interested in why you think that we can go ahead with this case without certifying to the Supreme Court, the California Supreme Court. But have in mind, we want your logic, because there's no right with the attorneys one way or the other. If the court needs it, we're going to do it. So tell us about whether we need to actually certify to the California Supreme Court, and if you believe we don't need to, why?
Certainly. So first of all, Robinson Helicopter is very clear and explicit in determining that it is not extending the economic loss rule exception to omissions. And let me read from the opinion itself. This is page 276 of the opinion. It said it was clear that its ruling was, quote, narrow in scope, unquote, and, quote, limited to a defendant's affirmative misrepresentations on which a plaintiff relies and which expose a plaintiff to liability for personal damages independent of the plaintiff's economic loss, unquote. And so that's two things. It says that its ruling is narrow. It is only extending so far as affirmative misrepresentations, and that those misrepresentations need to be alleged to give rise to, quote, personal damages independent of the economic loss. And neither of those criteria is met here. There's no affirmative misrepresentation that's alleged. There's no allegation of personal damages independent of
how would you counsel distinguish, I guess? And the question is, should we distinguish, and how would you distinguish between affirmative misrepresentation cases and fraudulent concealment cases? There are some courts who think that both claims should fall within the exception.
Yeah. And I think the difference goes to the center of the policy of the economic loss rule, which is that we don't want parties taking breach of contract claims and repackaging them and calling them tort claims and proceeding on that basis. And there's a big difference with that perspective in mind between affirmative misrepresentations and omissions. So in Robinson Helicopter, one of the reasons that the Supreme Court gave for having some comfort in permitting that fraud claim is it said there was an independent thing going on there. There were false certifications of compliance that were being provided, and that was separable from the contract damages, and that was what opened the door to the affirmative.
Counsel, could I interrupt you there? Could I interrupt you there, please? Because you said it's separate from the contract damages, and it seems to me it's separate from the contract duty. I want to go back to Judge McGee's point. I'm trying to figure out, where's this duty come from? Right. So in Robinson Helicopter, if we're going to use that as an example, which seems fair, if the part had showed up, I think it was a clutch or something that hadn't been made to specifications, and if that part had showed up without any representation about anything, it still would have been a breach of contract, right? Because the supplier wouldn't have performed its contractual duties. But it seems to me that what the California court found is there's another duty, a tort duty arose because they did more. The defendant did more than just present the defective part, that also affirmatively certified that it was in compliance with the contract, right? So in that example, it's pretty easy to see why there's an independent tort duty. But you're not tying the duty, you're not speaking of the contract duty, you're speaking of contract damages, and so that's why you're losing me.
Yeah, and I think the court put it better than I did. So Robinson Helicopter, there was a contract duty to provide the compliant helicopter clutches. And then the court found there was a separate obligation of don't defraud the customer by issuing these false certificates. So there were two different things going on, and they were separable. And that's why Robinson Helicopter permitted the fraud claim to go forward. Now, in this case, there is nothing separate. There's only one duty which is being alleged. It was explicitly alleged as a contract duty, and there's nothing separable about it. There's just an alleged failure to disclose Uber's business plans. And that's illustrative of why omissions are very differently situated from affirmative fraud. It's very easy to take a breach of contract and say that you didn't tell me you were going to breach the contract, or you didn't tell me the facts that led you to breach the contract. And so if you open the door to omissions claims, under the Robinson Helicopter Doctrine, you basically undo the dead center of the economic loss rule. Anybody, like Rattagan has done here, can take the same thing that was alleged to be a breach of contract and call it an omission. And Robinson Helicopter itself is very clear that to avoid opening the floodgates in that manner, that's the phrase that the court used, they're only going this far and no farther. And so the court should have a great deal of comfort that Robinson Helicopter made a deliberate decision to stop at the line between affirmative fraud and omissions. The other aspect on certification is that under the California rules of court, to certify an issue, there needs to be an absence of controlling precedent. That's not the case here. Robinson Helicopter is controlling precedent. And the decision needs to determine the outcome of the case.
Well, but you say Robinson is controlling precedent, but Robinson specifically said we're not going to look at fraudulent concealment. So they're saying they are not going to weigh in on whether fraudulent. Could have been very easy for them to say one way or the other, and they chose not to, I guess. I mean, I say it easy. I assume they could have taken that on, but they decided not to. Then you look for appellate court, other appellate court decisions, and there's none. And then we have these district courts, and the slight majority end up saying, it probably is not an exception to the economic loss rule. But is that enough for us to reasonably predict what the California Supreme Court will do?
I think so, Your Honor. I mean, the California Supreme Court was faced with a case in which they could have created an exception for omissions and deliberately chose not to. So in some ways, you don't really need to predict what they would do. That's exactly what they've already done. I think the other reason why certification wouldn't work here is that there's so many additional grounds for affirming in this case that it's really not a dispositive issue. And the one that we focused on in our brief was that there's no plausible allegation of a duty on the part of a client to disclose the information that Uber was allegedly supposed to hear. There is such a thing as a claim for attorney malpractice. There is not such a thing as a tort of client malpractice. And that's for very good reason. The attorney-client relationship is unique in that the attorney is in a position of great power and special knowledge. And so they have duties of loyalty and disclosure to their clients. The reverse is not the case. And we do not want to open the door where a client who is, where an attorney who's dissatisfied with how the relationship went can sue his client in tort and have that be a permissible remedy. And Mr. Rattagan has not identified a single case in which a duty like that had been located or recognized. And so that's an independent reason to affirm that has nothing to do with the economic loss rule. And so given that the economic loss rule doesn't even determine the outcome in this case, it's not a good candidate for certification. I want to briefly address the special relationship test, which seems to be the focus of the briefing in this court. And there, I would say, first of all, it's waived and doesn't need to be reached. But additionally, as we pointed out in our briefs, the special relationship test is something that really only applies in this kind of bystander prong of the economic loss rule, where, you know, for example, you're the cabinet maker and you're not in privity of contract with the manufacturer of the sander, but maybe you have a special relationship and can bring an economic loss type of claim there. In situations where there is privity of contract, where the parties are contracting with each other, the special relationship test doesn't exist. And Mr. August cited the E-Trade case, which was a Northern District Magistrate Judge opinion, finding to the contrary. But that's contradicted by clear California Court of Appeal authority in the stop-loss case. And also, if we're talking about unpublished opinions, this court, including two members of this panel last year in a case called Burke, found that the special relationship test does not apply when the parties are in contractual.
Unfortunately, those are not presidential, and we have directed by rule that they are not to be cited to us. You'll have to skip that argument, I think.
I'll go ahead and skip that argument, but I will say that the doctrine is entirely clear, and stop loss is decisively clear, that when the parties are in contractual privity, you just never get into the special relationship test to begin with. And that has to be the rule in a circumstance like this one, because we're right at the center of the economic loss rule, the repackaging of contract duties as tort duties. Is the very thing that the economic loss rule is intended to prevent. And if you find that parties to a contract are allowed to invoke torts, you would always find a special relationship. And that's the reason that stop loss and so many other cases have determined that the special relationship exception just does not apply in a case like this one. Ultimately, in this case, there's really only one allegation, which is Rattagan's allegation that Uber breached a contract to him. He missed the statute of limitations for that contract claim, and the economic loss rule squarely forbids repackaging that as a tort claim. Unless the panel has further questions, we'll submit.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. August, I think I'll give you a minute. I think you have less than a minute, but I'll give you a minute.
Sorry, I need to unmute. Both yourself and Judge Kristen have focused on this issue. Where does the duty come from? Throughout our papers, we talk about the independent duty deriving from confidential relationship, attorney-client, client attorney, we talk about agency, and we talk about social policy. I think the court can look to all three of those to find the source of the duty. But more to the point of Mr. Davidson's argument that this case is all about a contract, find me the language in the contract that addresses the party's actions relating to what the client has to do or say or tell or disclose or not disclose to the lawyer. There is none, because there was no contract. There's no formal contract. It's essentially an oral agreement reflected in some emails, and then services provided, and then service paid for. The separate duty here is the disclosure of what they were doing, knowing that what they were doing was perceived to be unlawful. They were told that, and that Rattagan would be potentially injured. The contract duty or the contract obligations that we're talking about that are in the quote contract, close quote, are his responsibilities to perform legal services and get paid for them. And then last but not least, the special relationship issue that Mr. We've cited in our papers why it was not waived. It was raised before Judge Chen. No reason to rehash that. But the fact of the matter is, if you adopt the premise...
Okay. You're beyond your time. So unless anybody has any other questions, I think we will take the rest of your arguments as they've been presented in the briefs. Thank you very much, both of you, for your oral argument presentations here today. The case of Michael Rattagan versus Uber Technologies is now submitted.
Thank you. That
concludes our session for today. Thank you.
Rise. This court for this session stands adjourned.